Thank you. morning on this beautiful, warm, wonderful April morning. You know what they say. Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome. I have several announcements here. I just need to look upon the screen to see which order they expect me to be doing them in. And you have the music on. This is the last day for ordering Easter flowers. We are offering Easter lilies, daffodils, and hyacinths. The plants will be in the sanctuary for Easter Sunday, and you can take them home or share them with a friend or a senior or a shut-in after the service. It's up to you. They must be paid for today. Donnie will take checks and cash and order forms in the back. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, the celebration and beginning of Holy Week, one of the most special weeks of the Christian calendar year. Join us for worship and a special program put on by our children. I had the opportunity of sitting in on part of practice this morning, and they sounded good. So they will do a great job, and you will be blessed next Sunday at our usual time. Friday, April 15th at 7 o'clock in the evening. We will be having a Good Friday service with a musical program put together by our own Dr. Nick Weiser. Did you stand up because you had something you wanted to say about it? Or should I just tell everybody that you know what a wonderful job he does? I'm sure Friday will be inspiring, to say the least. In missions, we'd like to thank you for your UMCOR Sunday offerings that were taken last month. They cover the administrative costs, enabling UMCOR to take everything else and put it in the field where it's needed. We are still collecting, UMCOR is still collecting for Ukraine. If you mark your checks with Ukraine on it, we will see that they go to the Ukraine portion of the UMCOR budget. If you'd rather donate online, you can do that also. It's a new month. Our mission offerings for the month will go to Blessing Beds in cooperation with PTEC and Erie 2 BOCES. We've made beds for children without beds. We would like to make more. So this month's offerings for mission will be put towards that cause. We will be assembling 100 flood buckets this week. Set up for the buckets will be Friday at 9 o'clock in the morning, downstairs in the community room. Assembly of the buckets will be Saturday at 9 o'clock in the morning. If you're willing and able to help, please let us know. You can call the church office or contact Mary Cole. Thank you for your help. And Kathy Peterson has an announcement she would like to make.
Good morning. After a long hiatus due to that awful bug, the Hannah Hasbrook Peterson concert series is starting up again. Our first concert will be Friday night, this coming Friday night at 8 o'clock here. It's always free. We have a high school choir coming, or a college prep choir coming from Cleveland. The conductor is a former Fredonia. He's a Fredonia graduate. And the Fredonia Chamber Choir will also be taking part. It'll be about an hour long, but it sounds like it's really going to be fun. So I hope everybody can come. Thank you.
Let us pray. Father, we are so grateful to be here today. We are so grateful for your love for us, that you use imperfect, weak flesh humans such as ourselves, that you fill us with your love, that you give us your grace, your priceless grace, that you are here with us, and we know that confidently because we are gathered here together in your name. Bless this service and the people in it. Help us to praise you, reach out to you, feel your love, and leave inspired to do your will. In the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Savior, we pray. Amen. Dr. Weiser will provide us with some music. Let us all stand and join in our call to worship and our opening hymn. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream.
Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy.
Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them.
The Lord has done great things for us. We are glad.
Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the watercourses in the Negev. Those who go forth weeping, bearing the seed for sowing.
The Lord has done great things for us. We are glad.
Let us join in our opening hymn, number 92 in the hymnal, for the beauty of the earth as we invite in the light of Christ.
Continue on in our time of service. We're going to sing a praise song entitled Your Grace Is Enough.
Great is your grace.
There's a lot to be concerned about, a lot to share with God, a time to know that He loves as much as we love, that He cares as much as we care, and even more. We think today about all of the people looking at medical concerns this month. Of course, Jen Osborne Coy, Jessica Sinclair. Becca will be having a procedure on her throat very shortly. Pastor's grandson Miles is undergoing tests for neurological problems. Karen Mathewson has surgery scheduled. Tom Cooper will be having a procedure down in Virginia. My son will be having a bone marrow transplant this month. Colleen and Doug's great niece Kennedy is in New Zealand. She's been air flighted to a hospital in New Zealand with an intestinal infection. This just happened recently, and she's doing okay as of this morning, which is nighttime in New Zealand. It is nice to know that we worship a God who can help in New Zealand, as well as here, as well as Ukraine. Let us pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for bringing us here this morning. Thank you for your hand of protection and care and love upon each and every one of us. Thank you for the joy you inspire in us. Thank you for the strength you give us to bear the things that are difficult to bear. Thank you for giving us shoulders to cry on. Thank you for giving us your shoulder to cry on. Thank you for your faithfulness, your love, your concern, your grace given to us in innumerable measure. We thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who came down to be one of us, to show us way, truth, and light. We think of this especially as we approach Holy Week, in which we commemorate the death of your Son and look forward to the celebration of his resurrection in 2 weeks. Pour out upon us your Holy Spirit, the gift which you have given to us to make us more like you, to make us love, to make us smile, to make us care, to make us concerned, to make us celebrate, to represent you, so that your kingdom of love, acceptance, joy, and community may be brought here as it is in heaven. We take this moment now, Lord, for each of us to mention a name or two or three or four of people that are on our hearts. And we ask you for their blessing. For your blessing on them. And this assurance we have, Father, that we know you have heard. And we know that you care, and we know that you love.
pour your grace out upon us and upon them. Comfort those who need comfort. Encourage those who need encouraging. And help us all to sense your blessings in a greater way all throughout this week. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
I'd like to ask the children to come on up, if you would. Thank you, praise team. Have a seat. I think you'll like this. I don't know. Is that better?
Oh. Okay. I washed my hands before I did this.
I hope I have one for everybody. And I know we had quite a few people in the choir and some people who are like pretending to be children just to get some peeps, but we'll let them have some too. I would have brought it back to her. If you grown-ups are going to be jealous, I would point out that this is church. And jealousy is not a good thing. Nevertheless, we do have coffee in the narthex after church. And in something no one has said in a long, 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 long time, there are baked goodies to go with the coffee after church. So while they get their peeps, you can have the baked goodies. I bought the peeps, but don't worry, I didn't bake. Who wants peeps? There you go.
Say thank you.
You're welcome. There you go. Your favorite color is pink. All right, that's fine. Thank you. Okay.
Charlotte's favorite.
Charlotte's pink. What? Oh, she got pink. Okay, we're fine. You want pink or you want pink?
I want blue.
Blue. Please. Take the pink. Take the blue. Can you get yellow?
Yes.
Yep. What do you want?
Okay. Thank
you. You're welcome. Oops, sorry. Welcome.
Welcome. Oh, take one. Pass one. Take one, pass one. Look at this. One, two, three.
Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome so much. Look at that. An absolute miracle. Just enough peeps for everybody.
Yeah.
The peeps have a sticker on them. Can I get a volunteer to stand up and read that sticker to everybody?
I've already read mine.
Oh. They don't know what the sticker says.
Yes.
There you go. Stand up. Read the sticker.
A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed.
Where'd that come from?
Proverbs 11:25.
Thank you. So, where did the peeps come from?
Proverbs 11:25.
Oh, where did you get the peeps from?
Walmart.
Now, could you put that slide up? Could you put that slide up? It's one of those days. I can live with it. I bought them. I have a receipt that says I bought them. Okay, but. But there's something you need to understand about them. I mean, how could I buy them?
Money.
How could I have money?
God's help.
Working.
How could I work?
God's help.
This guy's got the answers right here. How could I work? Because I had talent. Because I could do things. People would give me a job and give me money. Where does my talent come from? Where does my learning come from? It came from my parents. It came from teachers. It came from interest. Where did that all come from?
Lord. It
came from where God put me. Came from where God put me. So if God didn't put me where he did, and God didn't help me where he did, I couldn't have those. You couldn't have those. And I'm happy that God put me where he put me. Well, that's it. And what does the sticker say? I'm so happy that he put me here that I could share. And as I share, God will make me happy. And if you share, God will make you happy. I mean, but like, I'm not special. You heard Nick play the piano. He has talents. He understands notes. He understands rhythm. I know people who don't understand notes and rhythm. I mean... You heard Brenda sing. She sings much better than I can. Something breaks. Mr. Lafferty can fix it. Mr. Lafferty can fix everything in this building. I can't. The only thing I was allowed to do when I was a kid is hold the piece of lumber that my father was sewing. I can't fix a thing. Becca can keep me in focus as I wander from side to side. I mean, everybody has things they can do. And in the end, everybody, everything that we are comes from God. And when we say thankful, we're grateful.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Amen. We're grateful to God. I'm sorry you didn't get a... Not only did you not get peeps, I lost my... I lost my prop for the message. I would like us to stand and everyone to stand. I would like someone to say the Lord's Prayer. I have one volunteer. Let us pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
If adults, if you feel comfortable walking up to someone and giving them a blessing, please do so. If you don't want anybody walking near you, please be seated. But take this opportunity to respect those who are uncomfortable and to give blessings
to our brothers and sisters, and the children are dismissed to eat all that sugar.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Joe, I'm willing to say another big verse.
Which one?
John 3:16. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. Anyone who believes will not perish, but have eternal life.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Those are not yours. Good morning. God bless you all. Be seated, please.
Okay, well, good morning then. Today's first reading comes from the book of Isaiah, from chapter 43, verses 16 through 21, as found in the English Common Bible. The Lord says, who makes a way in the sea and a path in the mighty waters, who brings out a chariot and a horse, army and battalion. They will lie together and will not rise. They will be extinguished like a wick. Don't remember the prior things. Don't ponder on ancient history. Look, I am doing a new thing. Now it sprouts up. Don't you recognize it? I'm making a way in the desert, paths in the wilderness. The beasts of the field, the jackals and the ostriches will honor me. Because I have put water in the desert and streams in the wilderness to give water to my people, my chosen ones. This people who I'm formed for myself, who I will recount my praise. The second reading is from the letter of Paul to the Philippians, chapter 3, verses 4 through 14, as found in the English Common Bible. We don't put our confidence in rituals performed on the body, though I have good reason to have this kind of confidence. If anyone else has reason to put their confidence in physical advantages, I have even more. I was circumcised on the eighth day. I am from the people of Israel and the tribe of Benjamin. I am a Hebrew of the Hebrews. With respect to observing the law, I am Pharisee. With respect to devotion of faith, I harass the church. With respect to righteousness under the law, I'm blameless. These things were my assets, but I wrote them off as a loss for the sake of Christ. But even beyond that, I consider everything a loss in comparison with the superior value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. I have lost everything for him. But what I lost, I think of as sewer trash, so that I might gain Christ and be found in him. In Christ, I have righteousness that is not my own and that does not come from the law, but rather from faithfulness of Christ. It is the righteousness of God that is based on faith. The righteousness that I have come from knowing Christ, the power of his resurrection, and the participation of his sufferings. It includes being conformed to his death, so that I may perhaps reach the goal, the resurrection of the dead. It is not that I have already reached this goal, or I have already been perfected, but I pursue it, so that I may grab hold of it, because Christ grabbed hold of me for just this purpose. Brothers and sisters, I myself don't think I've reached it, but I do this one thing. I forget about the things behind me and reach out for things ahead of me. The goal I pursue is the prize of God's upward call in Jesus Christ. May the reading of the word inspire and encourage his people. Please stand for the Gloria Patri.
Standing for a reading from the Gospel of John, the 12th chapter, verses 1 through 8. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." May the words of the gospel breathe living truth into our hearts, refresh our spirits, and enable us to grow in wisdom and truth and love. Amen. You may be seated. A quick, easy quiz. If I say something, what are the next five words? I believe in God, the Father Almighty. That's more than five, but it's all true anyway. We're familiar with the Apostles' Creed. We say it frequently and many times. I'd like to share another creed with you that's in our hymnal, but we don't say it as often, the Nicene Creed. This particular creed was written in the early history of the church in about AD 325 by an early general convention. I like putting it that way. An early general convention held in Nicaea, modern-day Turkey. Contains some alternate wordings, but not any words we don't believe. I'd like to read just part of it. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. One being with the Father who became truly human, truly God and truly man. I mean, this is a completely appropriate time of the year to consider truly human Jesus as we approach Holy Week and Good Friday. I want to talk about truly human Jesus and draw a truly human picture that we may not always understand. Many of us enjoy a television series based on the life of Jesus as told in the Gospels. I want to point out the difference between TV Jesus and real Jesus. Not in the words, but in the surroundings. TV Jesus sits in an air-conditioned trailer in his dressing room in between takes. Real Jesus lived 1,900 years before there was air conditioning. TV Jesus had a makeup artist and a hairstylist to prepare for the next take. Real Jesus didn't. TV Jesus gets clean robes from wardrobe before the next take.
Real Jesus didn't. At the end of the day, TV Jesus gets a ride back to a local hotel for dinner, a shower, and a soft bed. Real Jesus didn't have a shower. What's the point? I mean, this is the real Jesus, just like you or I, not something special. Jesus walked through desert and farm areas in bare feet and sandals. You do that long enough, your feet get calloused because you are truly human. You walk around in a hot desert area and you sweat because you are truly human. You walk in bare feet through sand and dirt and your sweaty feet get dirty because you are truly human. Sometimes we have this idea that we sanitize Jesus, making him something other than truly human. But we, considering Jesus as truly human, kind of gives this reading more impact. We want to consider a fully human, sweaty Jesus with smelly, calloused, dirty feet, which Mary anoints with expensive perfume and wipes with her hair. Which Mary anoints with expensive perfume and wipes with her hair. If the children were here, I would probably have an ew, gross, coming from behind me. But let's use a couple of mature words instead. Number one, extravagant. Nard, or spikenard, is a fragrant oil which is made from a plant that doesn't grow in the Promised Land, that doesn't grow anywhere near the Promised Land, comes from the Himalaya area of northern India. The MRSV says a Roman pound was used by Mary. That's about this much. Okay, that's a Roman pound of nard. You can buy nard. You can, the internet, you can buy anything. Mm-hmm. You can buy a bottle of nard this big for $66 plus shipping and handling. So if this costs $66 plus shipping and handling, how much do you think this costs? And that's today, where we have air freight and FedEx and factories and machines. Gosh. I mean, that, you know, we're still talking $9,000 in today's money with today's technology. But imagine what you would have to pay for nard if it was walked from northern India to Bethany. Walked from northern India to Bethany. Whoa, those are shipping and handling charges. 300 denarii, which Judas pointed out, was roughly a year's wages. I've seen an estimate that that's about $45,000 worth of nard. That is an extravagant amount of nard. Next word, humbling. All this foot care was the role of the household servants, not the role of the host and hostess, the household servants. Mary of Bethany was lowering herself into the place of a servant, humbling. Humiliating with her hair, really? Ooh, that's why the kids would say, oh, gross. Humiliating. How's another word for you? Controversial. In that culture, women didn't touch men other than their husband. Mary touched a man. Scandalous. Shocking. Let the gossip begin. Extravagant. Humiliating. Humbling. Controversial. Which brings me to the big question. Why? Well, Jesus gives one answer in verse 7. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. But as the Bible story goes on, as you read in all four Gospels, doesn't really appear that anybody has a clue that Jesus' burial is coming. So what else could have motivated Mary to such an extreme display of what? Oh. Verse 1 has the answer. The previous appearance of Mary in the Gospel of John, Lazarus has died. Martha has met Jesus and went back to the house to get Mary. When Mary arrived where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died." When Jesus saw her crying and the Jews who had come with her crying also, he was deeply disturbed and troubled. Jesus wept and raised Lazarus from the dead. So was Mary's act an act of worship or an act of gratitude? But I struggled with that one for a while. And then I decided to do what you do when you get to something you struggle with. You look for what other wise people said. And here's the sort of thing I found. We all likely recognize the importance of being thankful, but how many of us truly see gratitude as an important part of our worship? We might associate praise, love, and joy with worship, but thanksgiving? The affections of our hearts are central to true worship. Yet while praise, joy, contrition, and love are all important for worship, I believe gratitude is the most important worship affection. Have you thought about the role of gratitude in worship? Have you thought about the role of gratitude in your life? Have you thought about the role of gratitude in relationship to your relationship with Jesus Christ? Did gratitude get you out of bed this morning? Did gratitude bring you to church? Or did obligation bring you to church? There is a God, I'm not it. There's another quote I found. I am not the sole inventor of my own success. I cannot justify myself. I cannot complain complete credit. The parable of the peeps. I am the recipient of enormous grace. I was born into a country I did not choose. I was given a family I did not earn. My skills and honed with the guidance of coaches and mentors. My successes came from opportunities that wouldn't have existed without other people. Even the food on my table was picked by others. Every day that I live comes to me as a gift from the God who sustains my breath. The possibility of me being connected to that God in a real relationship is entirely grace and mercy. When I realize these things, the only rational response is gratitude. The Bible calls that response by another name as well, worship. When we see all that God has done for us and we respond with gratitude, we are worshiping. And this kind of worship is particularly important. It isn't just an emotional response, and thank you isn't just something you say. It's a discipline that changes your heart. Gratitude keeps us centered. It corrects our thinking that all we are and all we have came to us by our own efforts. And it opens the doorway to a real relationship with God. Pastor Mark Allen Shelsky, how's your gratitude quotient looking? I was supposed to have peeps. I gave them all away, so I can't do my peeps illustration. But I have two things I can do with a package of peeps. I can share it, or I can grab it tightly and squeeze it and say it's mine. What happens to a package of peeps when you grab it and squeeze it tightly? You should be grateful I don't have an opportunity to do that. Looking for blessings, share blessings. Recognize the source of your blessings. Let your gratitude towards God show towards all. And then this is not necessarily about money. I mean, it sounds like a story about money because we're impressed with how much a Roman pound of nard costs and the fact that it comes from the Himalayan mountains. If God asks you to be generous with your money, be generous with your money. If God asks you to be generous with your time, be generous with your time. Let that crazy driver who has to cut ahead of you to make the green light go through the green light. Wait for people to cross the street. Be generous with a smile. Be generous with a compliment. Be generous with encouragement. Invite somebody over for dinner. Write a letter. Make a phone call. Walk a dog. Be generous with what has been given to you because it comes from God. And as you are grateful for what you have given, that gratefulness expresses itself in gratitude and in giving. Again, not necessarily of money, but of yourself, your gifts, your abilities, your time, your friendship, your love for others. Let your gratitude towards God show towards all. That brings the kingdom here. Father, we thank you for everything. That sounds appropriate today. Help us to acknowledge you even more, the importance of your love and your gifts in our life. Your gifts of spirit, your gifts of physical talent, your gifts of mental ability, your gifts of time. Help us to use them wisely. Help us to use them as you would like us to use them. And help us to praise you all the more for all you have done for us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord, do thee.
Reminders for the week. If you want flowers for Easter, Donnie needs your money after church. While you're here after church, drink coffee and eat pastries. Smile at one another. Express your gratitude that you're here today and that you can see everybody else. Friday morning, get ready for flood buckets. Friday night, concert here. Saturday morning, make flood buckets. Sunday, children, Palm Sunday. Wonderful presentation, they sound great. And as always, thank you for your financial support of the church to keep the lights on, to purchase materials for the program, to keep the heat running, although maybe in a couple of months we won't need heat anymore, for supporting mission work around the world, for helping to support our hardworking employees who do all they can behind the scenes to make this possible. There's no better way to express thank you than the traditional Methodist method for givings, for grace, for the things that God has done for us. Please stand and join me in singing the doxology. Provided for us. All that God has provided for us is a wonderful gift to be celebrated. It is God's grace to us. No wonder they call it amazing. Our closing hymn, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
Be kind. Oops, I'm sorry. I'm ahead of myself. Kind, for everyone you meet is fighting a hard battle. This saying attributed to the Greek philosopher Plato dates back to almost 500 years before the birth of Christ. We have no idea what other people are facing, our friends in the pews, our friends in the community, the strangers we walk past. We do have an idea of what they need. They don't need to hear sacred music. They don't need to be in this building. They don't need the Bible. They need the grace of God, the love of Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit. When they have the grace of God, the love of Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit, all the rest will happen. They'll be here. They'll be praising. They'll be loving. Show gratitude towards God. Share gratitude towards God. Tell the world what they need to know. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Have a wonderful, blessed week.